Good morning. My name is John Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser, and that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the 17th chapter of Acts, and that will be read by Dr. Todd Chinook.
Good morning, class. Let us bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Gracious Father Yahweh, we thank you for allowing us all to be here this morning. And we know that it's just through your love, your grace, and your mercy that you have allowed us to even turn aside and keep that side turned, that we are looking at you. And we thank you for just the everyday things that you get us through, and that you keep our minds stayed and steady, that you are the focus, and all the others is really types and shadows that we may be able to see you in this physical. And thank you for allowing us to become conscious and to know you as you really are, because life eternal is to know. and all these things and many others we ask in thy son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Looking for strength to climb up the rugged hill,
he will bring things out all right.
Then look to King Yahshua and obey his every will.
Good morning, class. I will be reading Acts 17 chapter from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Traina and the Scripture Research Association Incorporated, reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Verse 1. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Saul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that the Messiah must needs have suffered, and risen again from the dead, and that this Yahshua, said he, whom I preach unto you, is the Messiah. And some of them believed, and consorted with Saul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews, which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren under the rulers of the city, crying, These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received. And these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Yahshua. And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. And when they had taken security of Jason and of the others, they let them go. And the brethren immediately sent away Saul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the Scriptures daily, whether those things were so. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women which were Greeks, and of men not a few. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of Yahweh was preached of Saul at Berea, they came thither also, and stirred up the people. And then immediately the brethren sent Saul to go, as it were, to the sea. But Silas and Timothy abode there still. And they that conducted Saul brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timothy for to come to him with all speed, they departed. Now while Saul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews, and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, What will this babbler say? Others said, He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange deities, because he preached unto them Yahshua and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, May we know what this new doctrine is whereof thou speakest? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else, but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Saul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are devoted to the worship of idols. For as I passed by and beheld your objects of worship, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you. Yahweh, who made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is ruler of heaven and earth, he dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things. And hath made of one man all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed, and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek him, if haply they might feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live, and move, and have our being, as some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of Yahweh, we ought not to think that gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's device can be like the Most High. And the times of this ignorance Yahweh winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained. Wherefore he hath given proof unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, We will hear thee again of this matter. So Saul departed from among them. Howbeit, certain men clave unto him and believed, among which was Dionysius the Areopagite and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. I have just read Acts the 17th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Good morning again. Okay, so today is Sunday. We'll be having a lecture format today. And for our first speaker, I would like to call on Todd Chinook.
Good morning again, class. So grateful and thankful to be up here and able to say anything about my Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And I've had a lot on my heart and mind lately, and things seem, how do I want to put this? There's been a lot of debate lately, let's put it that way, some debate. And what I've come to find out really at the end of the day is that the debate's always been going on in this school. You know, it's never stopped, not once. So what we're doing here today is just Yahweh overturning and overturning and overturning. It's nothing to get real upset about, in all honesty. But I would like to take this chance to finish up where I left off the last time I was able to speak on a Sunday here. I was speaking about the ages and dispensations, and it was very fascinating, and Sean noted it, that I only got up to a certain point, and then I ran out of time. So I would like to try and pick up where I left off. You remember? Does anyone else remember it? Other than Sean, I see Sean nodding his head. You don't really remember it? All right. Well, fair enough. So I was going through the entire ages and dispensations chart and attempting to read every verse that was on there so that we could see everything that is being said inside this chart and how it relates to the law and to the prophets. And so this idea that we're in the present kingdom age, that's not untrue. It's not an untrue statement, right? That we're in the fourth present kingdom age. However, to try and say that we're in a sixth dispensation is erroneous. And let me try and explain why. We have a pattern that we go by here. Okay, we got the gate, we have the altar of sin sacrifice, the brazen laver, the oil in the door, the most holy, the holy place. Then the second veil is the sixth step. The veil is the sixth step. Okay, I'm going to say it one more time. The veil is the sixth step. And then you have the seventh. Okay? Now, does anyone remember what this veil represents? Okay? And which angels are represented on this veil? That's right. Will Williams has gone a lot into this fact that these angels here are the fallen angels. Okay? These are the fallen angels. So, when Yahshua dies on the cross, what happened to this veil? It's rent in twain, but then what did Doc make a point to point out that just this wasn't just like a I just tore it, right? He ripped it out. Okay, it's gone, ripped out of the pattern, cast out of the pattern. Okay, cast out of the pattern. So then, what do you have if there's no more veil here? If it's been cast out, ripped out of the pattern, what we have now is the holy place and the most holy place are now one compartment. One. They aren't two places anymore because the sixth step has been ripped out. Okay? It's one compartment now. The five and the seven are together. 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 And the last thing that Doc did in 1975 was he took this six and he put it out. He took it out. He cast it out. The last thing he did, he cast out the six. And if you're gonna raise up a sixth dispensation now, then you're like a Pharisee who sewed his veil back together and stuck it right back up. Because here's the point. Yes, the fifth dispensation is what allows us to be in the holy place. Because Doc told us that when you're approaching that verse of Daniel, when you shall therefore see the abomination of desolation, stand in the holy place. Stand in the holy place. That's where he told you. Now, yes, back here, before the beast man of sin, or the Antichrist, is revealed. Can someone pull up that? The Antichrist, even though he works even now? Though he works even now until he be revealed, that the man of sin? It's either the Antichrist or the man of sin, which doth work even now, but who is already in the world, but until he should be revealed. Because what did Doc told us, right? Because that man of sin right here is the Pope. It's the Pope. Pope's the man of sin. Got the 666 on him. The mother of all harlots right here. We got that verse?
2 Thessalonians 2 and 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition.
Okay.
Who opposes and exalted himself above all that is called Elohim, or that is worship.
Sorry, I'm going to go back over here again. Exactly, the Pope. The Pope, the Pope, the Pope, the Pope. Okay? Until he should be revealed.
Okay.
So we do have a spiritual kingdom on earth with the disciples, okay, here in the fifth dispensation. And what I'm trying to point out is a lot of people have this fifth dispensation confused with the holy place. They think that because I'm standing in the knowledge that even unto this day, Pentecost is still happening, that means I'm standing in the holy place. Well, I'm saying, sort of. Because the Pentecost is what rips your sixth step out so that you can be in the holy place with all seven steps of the pattern. Because Doc doesn't want us to go just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He didn't teach us six steps. He taught us seven steps. Seven steps to the pattern. So where do you want to be? Do you want to have the full knowledge of all seven steps or not?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then you got to come on over. You got to give up this sixth dispensation idea. The six is, that's a representation of the Antichrist, the devil and his demons. That's what that represents. So I've heard this called the Kinley dispensation recently. And that is a terrible thing to say. Because none of us knew Dr. Kinley unless you were his wife and his kids, right? Basically. They knew Dr. Kinley before he died in 1931. The rest of us don't. And if you put two and two together, well, then you understand who was really in that body. Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua were in that body, revealing that beast man of sin and fulfilling the entire scriptures, because we have Habakkuk 2 and 2, right? Habakkuk.
Right.
Please.
Habakkuk 2 and 2. And Yahweh answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that everyone may read it fluently.
There you go. See, that's a prophecy. It was a prophecy. And the one known as Dr. Kinley fulfilled that prophecy. Okay? Now the entire scriptures are fulfilled. Every jot and every tittle through Dr. Kinley got fulfilled. Do we understand? Because that was a prophecy about him. So if we know anything about fulfillment, who do we know fulfills things? Who fulfills things? Yahshua fulfills things. That's right. Yahshua in that body fulfilled it all. The scriptures, done. He did it in that body. Yahweh did it in that body of Dr. Kinley. Okay? So that's why we had to have a spiritual kingdom on earth in a fourth age. Okay? Because Dr. Kinley hadn't come along yet and fulfilled it in the final step. The seventh step fulfilled the seventh step and brought illumination to our most holy place. Now, he told us you got to be in the holy place. And when this is rent, it's one compartment. See, God, they both got the name holy. And as has been discussed recently, what does holy mean? The pure. Pure place. A pure place. So, 1960. The age ended. What age? If he was telling us that we were in a spiritual kingdom on earth, and then in 1960 came along, and he says, okay, age ends. What age does it have to be? It has to be the fourth age. The fourth one. And yes, there is a probationary period. In my conversion experience, I've said it from this floor, the voice told me, this is the investigative judgment. I was under the judgment of Yahweh at one point in my life, where he was examining everything and making me take notice of what's really going on in my life and how it lines up to this pattern. But then there comes a point where you are sealed. You're sealed in the Holy Spirit, and then you don't have to be on probation anymore. You don't have to be on probation anymore. And I just don't understand why we keep wanting to say, no, everyone's on probation. Because here, look at this six, this Kinleyan dispensation. The six is the representative of the beast man of sin, who Dr. Kinley exposed for us, kicked it out in 75, kicked it out. So, while I'm a little bit scared of numbers, I'm going to try and do some numbers here. Okay?
Okay.
1960. All right. Now we understand that the new age, the fourth age, didn't start until Pentecost, right? So technically speaking, we have to minus 33 years from the present, our present day, in order to get where the fifth age, the fourth age really started. Do we understand?
Okay.
Because they started it at the birth instead of at the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. They got it wrong, right? So we're 33 years off. So you got up minus 33 from 1960. All right, that's a 10. So this is a 7. That becomes a 5. So this is a 2. 9, 1. Okay, 1927. Well, we can't stop there because there's another 4-year error.
Right?
Right? It's 4 years. So we have to take that form now. We have to add it into this. Okay?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's 11.
31.
3. 9. 1. 1931. Okay? What year was the vision Dr. Kinley had?
1931.
So, in 1960, which is really 1931, he said the age ended. So, now you can, I'm going to let you do it on your own, but you can do this same thing, the same equation of minus 33 plus the 4 to your present today, and then see what year you're in.
Okay.
I'll just leave that there. Okay? Now, if you do the math, you'll find out that you're actually not to the year 2000 yet.
Right.
And Dr. Kinley said that we wouldn't make it to the year 2000. Now, a lot of people in this school had a falling out when the year 2000 came along and the Y2K didn't really happen. Well, it was the wrong 2000. Mm-hmm. So, really the point is the verdict's still out on whether Dr. Kinley's a liar, right? Because he made prophecies. And that was his prophecy. We wouldn't make it to the year 2000. So that's to be determined yet. Now, I'm not going to call him a liar. When he tells me the fourth age ended in 1960, I'm not going to say that it didn't. I won't call him a liar. Won't do it. I haven't caught him in a lie yet. Don't think I ever will. So, again, holy place. You must be standing in the holy place. You must have all seven steps. If you do not use all seven steps, then you miss the boat. Fifth age, seventh step. You got to have all seven. It's a revelation. I can't make any of you see it. I could just attest to the fact that I've seen it. I know it. I believe it. I have faith in it. And that's where I'm standing. And no one can take me out. And I just encourage you to keep studying. Because this sixth represents the veil of the flesh with Lucifer and his devils cast down into the earth plane. They're in bodies. So for you, you got to get that veil out of the way while you're in the holy place so you can have one unified compartment, the unity of Yahweh, and it will be real to you. And there's not much time left. It's all gone. It's up. It's done. You're just waiting on us. So that we can understand and see how the end has been declared from the beginning. Thank you for this time and your attention. If you got anything out of it, praise Yahweh Elam Yahshua. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Chinook. For our next speaker, I would like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
How's everybody?
Good.
I'm thankful and blessed to also be here in order to once again express the things that we've been taught according to a divine vision and revelation that we've been shown, and not that everybody understands things clearly. And I truly appreciate Todd for coming down once again, having been a member and associated with class, and have heard and investigated the things that we come to believe in. And we come to understand that what we believe is been given to us to know and believe. And as the founder often said, that he had a divine vision and revelation, and that don't believe him just because he said it. You understand? And so I concur, and I do realize that this is not a fight, that we may have differences of opinions and of thought, and there's nothing to haggle about because we're all brothers in the understanding about Yahweh our Elohim. Understanding Yahweh our Elohim is what he, as the moderator said, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, he himself took on a shape and form. Is that what the moderator said?
Yeah.
That he, Yahweh, pure spirit, knew that mankind could not perceive, meaning you're not going to understand him. At no time. And that he took on a super incorporeal shape and form. Not with blood, not with bones. Understand? And that he was going to have to make himself known unto men. We can read over here in Exodus 24:9. And that he showed himself to Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 of the elders. Understand? And he laid on hands. You understand? And they did eat and drink. But he laid not his hands on them. I mean, they didn't give them at this particular time, the children of Israel, any understanding. And so in this school, we endeavor to understand the mystery of Yahweh. Because Yahweh is a great mystery. Let me find that for me. Just look up great mystery. I think it's Corinthians, 1 Corinthians. And so we have to start somewhere. Because not everybody comes in on the same plate. Everybody comes in at various levels, if you would. And not a level of your understanding either. Because as Dr. often said, that when you come into this school, you have to trash everything you thought about. Yep. About your creator, about why, or who, or what you're about when you come into this school. Got to leave it at the door. Because what you've come to find out is that Yahweh our Elohim, that which you can perceive, is nothing like you've attempted to even understand. So we have a lot of dates. We have a lot of charts, which the charts are just a pictorial illustration of your Bible or our Bible. Started out with the King James Version, right? And now we have what we have, the Holy Name, which is just a A.B. Traynor's rendition of it. Because A.B. Traynor doesn't have 1 John 5 and 7 in that Holy Name Bible. True. In the Holy Name, you don't have it. Grab it, Doc. This to you didn't know. You grab 1 John 5:7. You have what I have about mystery.
1 Timothy 3:16.
Mm-hmm.
King James Version. And without controversy.
Now there's no controversy, like I said, and there's no fight because there's no controversy about this matter. Go ahead and read.
Great is the mystery of godliness.
Great is the mystery of Yahweh. Read.
God was manifest in the flesh.
Yahweh was manifested in the flesh. Read.
Justified in the spirit.
Justified in the spirit.
Seen in vain.
Hold on. You have to be, it is justified in the spirit. And you don't know what spirit is until you've come down and understood what Yahweh our Elohim, which is a super incorporeal being, which is these divine attributes in pure spirit having taken on a shape and form whereby you can perceive.
That's right.
Yahweh is intelligence, divine intelligence, divine wisdom, knowledge, love, beauty, foundation, power, and strength, right? But in this state, in condition, you're not going to perceive him.
That's right.
You're not going to understand how that spirit, and there's one spirit, therefore you have to come down to understand about this pure spirit and how it took on shape and form and how it's in a proper order. And there's a proper time frame. Therefore, we have an ages and dispensations chart, understand? Which is the creation that abides within Yahweh or eternity. We're in eternity now. But do we understand and do we realize how we are abiding in time? Because time is still ticking, as far as I'm aware. There's nothing that's immortal about where we're standing in. Now, that's the thing we have to, you know, go back to what you just read there in Timothy. What did it say?
God was manifest in
Yahweh
the flesh.
Yahweh was manifested in the flesh. That's John 1 and 1. If you're not sure about what I'm talking about, John 1 and 1 said, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was in with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. That's why Timothy, or the letter Saul wrote to Timothy, is expressing now. Read.
Justified in the spirit.
Justified in this, according to the spirit, not our physical, carnal perception or reasoning that we're going to understand spirit. That justification is not of the of physical thoughts.
That's right.
It's of a spiritual thought. Read.
Seen of angels.
Seen how? You're going to see with your physical eyes? And interpret what you see and what you feel, because we see time according to this chart as it's been expressed to us. The first age wasn't in the realm of time. The first age. Where's the demarcation of when that started? You follow? Because you have Adam and Eve up here in the garden for 40 days. There's a demarcation. You got a period of time. Got a grace period, if you would. Before the fall of Adam and the purpose being set forth.
Right.
And every age that I'm aware of, age being synonymous to a world, right, concluded. And there was a grace period before that world took off the flesh. Grace period between the... Now, the second age was in the realm of time. But you have to understand how that time began. Because you have the dispensations and ages, which are according to time. Mm-hmm. And according to time, there was a grace period at the end of every age. Now, there's three ages according to time. And as I said previously, we're still in time. The fifth age, sixth and seventh, is according to eternity. It's not according to time. That what needs to be justified according to the spirit, not according to a reasoning and a justifications of numbers. If I may, I don't like numbers neither, but I understand that we have to utilize these things. Because this is for our learning. Everything that Yahweh Elohim created, I say Yahweh Elohim created.
Right.
Yahweh didn't create anything
right.
Other than Yahweh Elohim. And then he went out and is creating business. That has to be understood according to a spiritual understanding. Not just a one-time statement. Whereby Yahweh Elohim transformed into this threefold tabernacle pattern. And then every synonymous day that he was shown to Moses according to a vision, whereby we're going to understand something about Yahweh Elohim. It ain't about learning about the stars and the galaxies. It's not about learning how to build a house or to build an ark. It ain't learning about what all of these beings down with Nimrod, how he set up a empire and understand how our government is formulated out. Because we can see that down to history of time. And it hasn't done mankind a bit of good. How the kingdoms have come down as Daniel puts it, right, from the city of Enoch, the Tower of Babel, and then you have Babylonians, the Medes, and the Persians. These are all great empires by which mankind has a culmination of all of this. It's where we get, is where we're at now in America, having come away with pagan Rome, papal Rome, down to England, you know, to Great Britain. The empire reigned over the whole world. They had control and power. And then you have America, a melting pot of all of this that was all set up. There's nothing new under the sun.
That's right.
So say Isaiah there. Yeah. Or no, that was Ecclesiastes, Solomon saying, there's nothing new under the sun.
Right.
You follow?
Right.
And Solomon didn't say that himself. Yahweh Elohim said that through Solomon to express that there's nothing new under the sun. Mm-hmm. What I have you holding? Keep reading. 2 Thessalonians.
Justified in the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Seen of angels,
mm-hmm.
preached unto the Gentiles,
mm-hmm.
believed on in the world.
Now, as preached unto the Gentiles, that was Saul's mission, because he was the apostle in order to preach unto the Gentiles. That's why you have Saul going all around Rome and everywhere else, preaching unto the Gentiles. We read it here in the 17th chapter of Acts. He was over there down there at Mars Hill, mm-hmm. preaching to them about the unknown Yahweh.
Right.
Where was he doing that at? The fifth dispensation, correct? Mars Hill, fifth dispensation. Keep reading.
Believed on in the world.
Some believed on him, right? As we read in the 17th chapter. Some believed and some didn't.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't no fight. You know, Saul getting out of there before they came. There's some that will want to fight. I have no doubt about that. It's going to get real hot before the end is over, because they're not going to believe what they think it ought to be. But nevertheless, it's not our fight, because the fight's fixed.
It really is.
The fight's fixed. And so, like you say now, we just have to use what we have, which these charts aren't holy. But yet they are an indicative sign of what's been expressed about in the scriptures. Keep reading.
Received up into glory.
Mm-hmm.
Go 4:1.
Go ahead.
Now the Spirit speaketh expressly.
Now the Spirit speaketh expressively. If you can hear. And have eyes to see and ears to hear. And what the donor brought to us is the vision and revelation that contains both Moses and John in a panoramic vision, whereby he's able to show how both John's vision, and we talked about it a few days ago, how the theologians until this day can't reconcile, bring their consciousness to the fact that John is confirming what Moses is writing about. Is an impossibility, as is said in the textbook, right? But yet we have a founder that came in on what? The sixth day now. We have Paul talking to them at Mars Hill that we read about in the scripture reading, right? And some believed and some didn't. And now we have the founder come in on this sixth day, sixth dispensation, right? Some believe and some don't. About how John is confirming what Moses is talking about. Has to. Isaiah 8:20. Hold that place in Thessalonians. Because I'm going to just read a snippet out of here. Because it's to the law and to the testimony. And they speak not according to this word. It's because there's no light in them. Light, we know, is the synonymous to understanding. Right? And that which we can understand, Isaiah 1:4. I just quoted Isaiah 8:20. But now let's grab down Isaiah, John 1:4.
John.
Mm-hmm. About this light.
Oh, yeah.
John 1:4.
Uh-huh.
In him was life.
In him was life.
And the life was the light of men.
And the life was the light of men. That light is the understanding of Yahweh Elohim. Understand? And we can have a period of time by which we can understand this light. As the previous speaker said, there's a grace period. On earth, because this is why the earth was recreated. It wasn't, as we said before, the scriptures, John 5:39, the scriptures aren't about the things in the book specifically. They're about Yahweh Elohim. And that's going to be the light or the understanding by which you're going to save your soul. Mm-hmm. While on earth. So say our ninth aim, mm-hmm. or tenth aim is to inherit eternal life now. In the kingdom, now on earth, where we're standing at. Now, we can't have an understanding that puts us, that translates us from conditions and situations on earth that we're all privy to, or circumjected to. But we don't have to act and be in any old kind of catawampus way. We can't invade it. We can't just disappear as Yahshua manifest. We can't just be immortal in this earthly vessel that we're still bound to. That's the point in which the previous speaker is expressing. That when you come to an understanding and you have a revelation about something, then it will free you from the bonds that you've been subjected to. That's what the revelation is. That's where this veil about a topic is made clear. Just as the world today sometimes says that we start in Genesis 1:1, and it's many of the people believe the world was created in 6 solar days. True. Now, when you understand how it was Moses on his second trip, and he was shown in a vision of when, where say John Exodus 24:16, in 6 days. Now, when you understand how that works, according if you've been drawn out to that, not everybody knows it.
Yeah.
Not everybody's immortal. Mm-hmm. Everybody's still in the flesh. That's why we're still teaching about Yahshua the Messiah. Because we haven't stepped over yet. So that we do know, that we can explain and understand how the world wasn't created in 6 solar days. It was created in the day. Now when it's brought out to a person and they have a revelation, when they once thought it was 6 solar days, mm-hmm. and they understand, they see according to the scriptures, then that veil, that concept has been written twain, if they believe. Now, Yahshua Messiah, and we know Yahshua Messiah wasn't like any other man. Huh? He was born from a virgin mother Mary. We know he's not Joseph's little boy, correct? He was a special prepared body. So say Isaiah 53 chapter. Specially prepared to do what? To save the world. John 3:16. He was created for the world in order to save the world.
That's right.
And so when this veil was written twain, what dispensation was it? Anybody? When this veil was ripped in twain. And don't forget. Did you grab me John 5:39? Just before we go further, let's get John 5:39 and make it really, really clear. That's a guess. That's not an answer. Go ahead.
John 5:39.
Okay.
Ye search the scriptures.
Now this is John in the 5th dispensation writing about Yahshua, what he said in the 4th dispensation. Read.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now, in the scriptures, you think you have eternal life, because now we know they didn't have no New Testament when John is writing this. Correct? So he only has the law and the prophets, because that's all that the Jews had. The Torah and the Pentateuch, right? And that's what they were searching that. They had all, we've read about the tulu that they used in the Jews put on their forehead. They knew the scriptures. They were aware of the scriptures. And that's what they studied. Keep reading.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now those scriptures are testifying of Yahshua the Messiah. Right. That's why I said it ain't about a boat. That's why I said it ain't about following after the Ten Commandment laws that Moses instituted, or that was given to Moses to give to the children of Israel, and try to follow that. We say that was those carnal ordinances were what they were given, right? The children of Israel, and that's going to be all nailed to the cross, because it wasn't about those things. That's what I'm expressing when I say it's not about Moses.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's about Moses, but then in the literal sense, it's not about Moses.
Right.
In a spiritual sense, you need Moses.
Right.
That's why I want to clarify that statement. So it's not about doing everything that Moses said do. Right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not about being from Abraham's literal lineage. Some people believe that they're actually going to be getting the, what's the thing with the family tree, ancestry.com, and they think they're going to be able to run their lineage all the way back to Abraham. Because they make it a cultural thing. They make it a fleshly thing. It's not about that. Right. Look at that spiritual principle. Because it's justified by the Spirit.
Right.
That's what we said the great mystery was.
That's right.
And so we're going to have to use these things in order to catch the continuity about the Spirit. Not the literalness of the matter. And so now you have Yahshua telling those scribes and Pharisees that were given the law. Right?
Mm-hmm.
While in the fourth dispensation, that they're not supposed to, you're not going to get eternal life by that.
Right.
By just reading the scriptures. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm.
That they are, they go back up and get it.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now they are they that testify of Yahshua the Messiah. Now, I asked a question prior to reading that. This tabernacle, which was constructed in the wilderness of Sinai, was before Yahshua the Messiah was born on earth through the loins of Virgin Mother Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And it was already constructed. It lasted and put out on Mount Zion. And then the temple, you have that veil, right? That's the veil that was ripped in twain. And what we're expressing is that when Yahshua Messiah, as the previous speaker said, and I full heartedly agree, when Yahshua Messiah was on the cross, that veil for him was written twain. That one for you at that time. And therefore, that veil was written twain in order of fulfillment of Yahshua Messiah. We have a question or a statement. Uh-huh.
The temple
was written to him.
Not the tabernacle.
That's all I was getting to. Because that tabernacle that was built in the wilderness, it was set out Mount Sinai. And so that veil is in the temple. And it was in the temple we have Yahshua going there and being shown how that temple was being, I think the Zerubbabel temple that was being built, right? And it was that veil in the temple that was written twain. But again, that was still in the fourth dispensation.
Right.
And again, I'm expressing that was built for the purpose of recognizing Yahshua the Messiah. And that is not open until everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Because it wasn't but 50 days later that they receive. If it was open to everybody, there wouldn't be no need for the pattern to have the 50 days from that rending of the veil until Yahshua Messiah had it until Pentecost, right? On the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which is happening until this day within this fourth kingdom age. The Pentecost is still, we're still learning. Because there's a grace period by way of the time that the founder has made the statement of 1960. Follow? Now, this is my rendition. This is my rendition. I'm not a numbers guy. But we got to make clear something. It was stated that we're going to subtract 33 years. How it was expressed. Mm-hmm. That's how we got 1927. And then we added, they added, a four-year error. Right. I have no problem with that in that mathematical equation. Because math can go both ways. 1960 is a Gregorian year. You follow me? When Yahshua Messiah was born, that's when they started year one. Correct? And then now we got to year 2021. Now. Right? Is that right? This is a Gregorian year that Dr. Kinney had addressed to a particular people. Because he oftentimes made statements too, that if you're not going to believe in the name of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, you're going to go to the lake of fire in 1960. He said that in L.A. But in Springfield, he said something else. So he makes a statement that's true. And that's why we're here yet trying to understand how is it so? And what's the time? And what's the cutoff date? Someone got a calculator?
I do.
1960 plus. Remember, the previous speaker said they counted Yahshua date 01, AD 1, right? And then they didn't understand that he came in 1933, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. After he hung on the cross, right, and poured out his Holy Spirit, was the start of the age. That's an advance. It's not a subtraction from this.
Got it.
Not a subtraction from year one. Remember, we've expressed that he went forward.
Right.
And the start of the age started after his death, 33 and a half years. Follow?
The new
age. Didn't subtract. He added.
Mm-hmm.
That was Gregorian time. A1. Where's the subtraction in that? I understand there's an addition. 1960. And really it's 33 and a half. If you want to make particular about it. Add it up.
Nineteen ninety-three point five is what you got.
Oh, let's not forget the four-year error. Go back. How much is that?
1989 and a half.
Look at the numbers. That will be prophetic time. That will be a reverse of that of a Gregorian time. Because we added the 33 years that they're not calculated in 1960. If he said that is the end, Yahshua died on the cross They thought that the birth of Yahshua was the start. And we understand it was 33 years later, which when the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was the start. Therefore, you have to add to it and not take away from it. Now, that's something to be understood. Now, subtract that from 2021.
Just
2021. It should be backwards, right? It should be 2021 minus 1989. What is it?
32.
Mm-hmm. I would conclude that we're in a grace period. And in a grace period. Take that number whichever way you want to express it. Yahweh repeats itself and turns itself over and over and over again, just as numbers work over, but they can go both ways. And yes, there's more to be understood and learned about how we actually use this number and how Dr. Kinney was looking at when he was making a statement and who he was making a statement to. Just as we've been expressed and admonished that we have to understand the scriptures according to how, who, and where the scriptures are being expressed at and who's talking, correct? That's how we've been admonished to know and make sure we know where we're at according to the time. 2 Timothy 2 and 5, rightly dividing.
Second Timothy or First Timothy?
Maybe First Timothy 2 and 5. And go up a little bit. See, this becomes where some may call contentious, right? We got dates, we got time. You got addition, you got a subtraction. You got addition, you got a subtraction. According to the same numbers, how is it perceived? How is it understood? That's what we want. That's just what we come to learn, right? That's why there's no fight. The other day, we were trying to go over some numbers. Coincidentally, how do you prove the birth date? How do you prove the date of Joshua, the son of Nun, being 30 years old? Mm-hmm. We hear it said all the time, but how do we come to that number? It wasn't like he was having birthdays and we able to follow his vestiges of time, right? And Sean worked it out beautifully on Thursday because he was a little bit not sure about how to prove that. He went home and worked with that. And it was beautiful to me that someone went home after class and worked with it and came back and expressed it, made it more clear for me.
That's right.
Of how you proved that. And that's all right.
That's right. Yeah.
Making a statement. And he called me on the floor. The way I was going wasn't a productive way. And all I want to leave here is just made it be known that, hey, there's a certain prescribed way we have to work the numbers. Mm-hmm. And how we have to add and subtract. Now, I'm not proposing that I know all which ways to go to bring a person into a full reality, because that's by will of Yahweh. But yet, we have two different opposing calculations. And that's why we have to come back and continue to learn and then ask and make that be clear. Because if the Gregorian calendar is wrong, as we know it is, because we know why. Because we start down here, the 12th chapter of Exodus, because we know that Yahweh told Aaron and Moses that this is going to be the beginning of months. And we know that's not according to the Gregorian calendar. Right? And if we know that that's true, and we know when they started to say that Yahshua Messiah was 81 at his birth, and that's not true. And we know, and we've been shown according to the scriptures, how that in 1933, Yahshua took all the flesh, and 50 days later, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit transpired, then that starts the new age.
Right.
And there was a grace period in that, just as there was a grace period with Noah for 120 years before the flood actually came.
Grant me Genesis 6:13.
You want to hold what do you got? Timothy?
Go give me 2 Timothy. It's going to fit right along with it. Read.
Study to show thyself approved.
This is what we're doing. We're studying to show ourselves approved. Hey, we got dates. We got numbers. We got times. We got a chart. We got the charts that the founder put together for why we can keep with the script. And so that we can be more perfect in the understanding of Yahweh Elohim. Read.
Study to show thyself approved unto Yahweh.
Unto Yahweh. Not man of God. Not me and you. You don't have to prove nothing to me. Yahweh's going to be the prover.
I'm telling you.
Read.
A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Rightly dividing the word of truth according to the scriptures and according to time. I have a time date that I go by in my physical world, but yet I also know there's a spiritual time date too, being justified by a spiritual understanding and not a carnal, literal understanding about a matter. Right? That's how we rightly divide the word of truth according to what we have, which is the ages and dispensations. Some out of time. The creative age. Was no time marker in there when those angels was cast out of heaven. Was no time marker there. Even when they was cast out, time hadn't began yet. And then you got Adam having in the antediluvian age in eternity. We're in eternity. I start off by saying we're in eternity now. This chart, orange cloud that goes all around this chart, is in the realm of eternity. It just matter how do you reconcile it to be so and understand how it is that we are in eternity. And where you place that within your carnal or your carnal mind, trying to reconcile a spiritual event. If it's that way, you would know that we have a time period in order to preach the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah within the time we've been allotted to give or to have, actually. Keep reading. I believe that's all of that.
But shun profane and vain babblings.
That's fine. Eunice, you have it?
Genesis?
Yes.
Six and
13-ish, maybe 12.
Genesis 6 and 12. And Elohim looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth.
Okay, keep reading.
And Elohim said unto Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me.
The end of all flesh has come before me. That was the end of an age, according to the Spirit. That's what Yahweh told Noah. But how long did Noah preach? Anybody have a guess?
120 years.
120. But Yahweh said the end of all flesh has come before him. But yet time still kept rolling with them until the flood in May 17th. Now, there's a whole number sequence in that to prove that date of May 17th. I don't have time to go into that, right? But yet we know and we've heard that before. Therefore, it behooves us to go back and to be sure in the things that we have been shown and have been taught, whereby what? We can love one another that may not be fully clear about the what? The unity of the Spirit, the tabernacle pattern, the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. A lot of people in this school still don't realize and understand those key fundamental elements to what? To have salvation and be prepared to move in to this state and condition. This is our grace period whereby we teach that which have been ushered into us. John 15:1. People don't understand that. A lot of people speak spiritually and feel as though they don't have any need for the flesh or or project themselves greater than what they might be, knowing full well that they're still subject to physical things and conditions and worries and concerns. Read.
I am the true vine. My Father is the husbandman.
That's 1 Corinthians?
No, you said John 15. What do you want?
1 Corinthians 15.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the glad tidings, or the gospel, excuse me. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received and wherein ye stand.
They who he's talking to have already heard the same story. He's speaking from the fifth dispensation. He's already telling them what they've already heard. And he's telling them again about the matter. It's a rehearsing, right? How are we going to go back and then rehearse something if we've already passed a timeline? A timeline that just shows no demarcation of a world ending or a world beginning. If we're already in this fifth kingdom age. And so we have to stand fast. Read.
By which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain.
We have to keep that which we've been taught. Because we're not making anything go anywhere. That's what we said. He says, by the gracious of Yahweh Elohim, that he has done all of his work. But he's showing us how and why. That's what he's doing Moses here in the vision. He showed how the world, which was created in a moment and an instant, which you would not be able to even perceive it coming to be. You wouldn't be able to see it. You can't even see the embryo when that point of time of conception takes place. You can't see it. You can't see it coming in, and we're not going to be able to see it going out. So what we can do is be faithful that for that which we can see and stand fast in remembrance of that which we've been taught. Because jumping ahead somewhere that you don't know not what it, that's what it's, keep reading here in 15, talking about a mortal body. Keep reading.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Okay.
How that Yahshua died for our sins.
This is how Dr. Kinley told us. He said how. How
that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
How that the Yahshua Messiah died according to the scriptures. Remember, John 5:39 said that the scriptures are about him.
Right.
And in him is life. Being somewhere or perceiving that you're somewhere is not life. Life is to know the one true El, and Yahshua, whom Yahweh has sent. That's life eternal, is to know that. And within the earthly realm of time, as we know time to be, this is how we're going to come to know about Yahshua the Messiah. Is what how he died. Read.
And that what he was buried and rose again the third day.
How do we prove that he rose again? Those are the how and how he was buried. In what fashion was he buried? Starting with Adam, how he was buried. And what state and condition brought down that burial. And how he rose again. People don't understand that. Some within the school can't preach and teach that. But yet, John is saying that this is the gospel. Saul is saying that this is the gospel. Whereby we might be saved. It's no different that Dr. Kenny coming in and confirming what Moses saw and John saw, giving us a panoramic vision of it all. And he didn't deviate from the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. Where are we at? Where are we going to be able to deviate into anything else other than the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua Messiah? and how he ascended or tarried on earth for 40 days and then ascended, right? And came back 10 days later at the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Where's we going to be able to go if we've done crossed the veil of time or out of an age? What else is it? Well, what more would there be to express other than a hope of coming into a conscious state whereby when this demarcation happens and you're not going to be privy to it, oh, here it comes. Let's get right. There's no time to get right. There's not going to be a time to go, let me go back to class. Doc said there'll come a time we may not be able to even gather together. One by one. We already have a little image of that when the pandemic came. They didn't know how to hold a class prior to the pandemic. Everybody wanted to proclaim Zoom as some phenomenal thing. Zoom had been around for years before the pandemic had came. And no one had realized what it was all about until Yahweh brought it to our attention. And he had given us a little bit more time in order to hear. Because a lot of people don't have time to see the church. We've been graced to be able to be here through all the pandemic and stand before you and give you a reasonable testimony about Yahshua the Messiah. Whereby we're not saying we've done progress. We're staying steadfast in the holy place and this realm. And you're right. There is a tabernacle which stands alone. And there is a tent that covers this. And there is a dividing line. But yet, in time, this veil being written twain is not according to Yahshua's written twain. This veil is still ever present. It has a body. It's a head region, a chest region, and a abdominal region. And we teach by that. Because, hey, lo and behold, you take away my neck, I have no life. That's the unity of the Spirit maintained on earth. Because if it was not necessary for me to have my neck region, which is the sixth step of the tabernacle, then I would be dead. But yet, it remains because there's still people that don't know the true gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. They don't know and understand. And we project anything other than what we've been given, we may do ourselves a disservice. Not may, but will. If we're going to take away any aspect of the unity of the Spirit. And this unity is a seven-step process with nine primary furnishings. And understanding how this structure and function operates are things that we yet still have to come into a consciousness of, whereby we can stand the test of time and stand gospels and conversations that will perceive to be something that it really isn't. 2 Thessalonians, start at 1. Is that making any sense why you can't separate the unity of the Spirit? And this is why that veil, although written twain, and although we have the mysteries that have been ushered in by Yahshua the Messiah himself, have no problem with not knowing Dr. Kinley in 1931. I met the man before, but I was a wee youngster. But I had no conversation with him. And whatever he said to me at that time, handed me a bit of good. Yeah. Taller. Yeah. He patted me on the head here or there, right? And like we said, some of us never ever met the man. But what we have met was his words. What he have met was his words. And you can't see my words coming out. But it's a type of a spirit. Whereas it resonates with you, the continuity and the flow by which he established, not me, not any numbers, but a doctrine whereby we can see how that spirit yet abides in me and in you. Yeah. 2 Thessalonians 1.
You want 1 and 1?
Yeah. I believe so.
Saul and Silvanus and Timothy unto the assembly of the Thessalonians and Yahweh our Father and our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
Still, Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior. We're in the body of Yahshua the Messiah, which is our Savior, because we have to know and understand him. That's what John 17:3 talks about, to know the only true El and Yahshua, the the Messiah whom thou hast sent. That hadn't passed. That was stated in the fifth dispensation. But Doc moved that six over there for a particular reason. Thank God he did. If you want to say it that way, because we got time, in order for us to understand something about this. Read.
Grace unto you and peace from Yahweh, our Father and Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
That's all we did. That's all we say every time we get on the floor. I'm thankful to be here. It's by grace that I'm here. And I'm happy that he's kept me here and keeping me here. Ain't gone nowhere. But yet we see the grace and we see the mercy by which he's bestowed unto us. By which we stand here today preaching the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
We are bound to thank Yahweh always for you.
Bound. That means we're locked into a state and condition of understanding the purpose. That's being, I think it's Ezekiel talks about, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living Elohim. Huh? That's being sealed in the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. That's the sealing that we want to take on and be in at this point in time. Waiting for what? Read.
Brethren, as it is fitting, yes, because that your faith groweth exceedingly.
Oh, yes, it got to grow. It's not an immediate thing. That's why we jot and tittles. As we say over there in Isaiah 28, 9 and 10, here a little, there a little. Line upon line, precept upon precepts. That's jot and tittle. A little by little, we begin to gain faith in that which has been given to us. Read.
Because that your faith groweth exceedingly.
Yes.
And the love of every one of you all toward each other.
We got to have love toward each other about preaching the faith of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what we have love doing. Not perceiving anything outside of that which we've already been taught and shown. Because the love will be, hey, beginning at Moses, at the burning bush. He saw an angel. He, Yahweh Elohim, saw him turn within his consciousness, preaching that Elohim told him that you're going to go down into a land and free his people. Understanding that migratory pattern takes our picture. That's the love that we are to preach. Don't let it get old. Don't let it get old. I've heard that swan song before. That's not nothing. I've already known about that. Don't get like that Lucifer that is expressed that we're on this veil. As though they know that which Elohim does. That's why Lucifer was cast out. That 14th plate, the angelic transgression, the most beautiful angel that there was, wanted to be like the Most High. But keep reading Thessalonians.
So that we ourselves glory in you and the assemblies of Yahweh for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure.
It's much patience for us to have a first-time visitor come in and we begin at Moses. It's much patience. That's much love. We may not know them after the flesh, but we do know that we may know them after the spirit. And we labor, not physically, but we labor according to the groanings that we utter, by which the Holy Spirit, as we hope, that when the speaker is on the floor, they're speaking by a power other than themselves, whereby it might resonate within their souls, that they may understand the vision and revelation that was given unto us. Because this is not my story. But yet the principle holds true throughout all of my life and all of your lives. If you have an open heart and you have an open mind to listen to what thus saith Yahshua the Messiah. Not me. But let's keep reading in Thessalonians.
Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of Yahweh.
Just a token. You know what a token is? You flip a token to somebody, he can have that. You keep that as a little morsel.
We give morsels out all day, every day, every time any of the schools throughout the nation or the world preaches the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. And if they're lining it up according to the purpose pattern of Yahweh, somebody, if you got it, stand fast with that. That's okay. Let Yahweh determine the days and the times and the seasons. You don't. You don't have the understanding nor the ability to do a thing other than to know Yahweh or Elohim. And that's by grace that he allow you to know. And if you see it, let it stand fast. Hey, that's why Daniel said stand fast in the holy place. If it was one all the way open, you wouldn't have a holy place. Because the holy place is right here. That is the fifth step. That is where we do our work. Huh? For 40 years, they tarried in the wilderness, right? Hey, there's a prescribed way that the high priest and the two low priests went into the holy place and performed their ministries in here day and night. Because it was always light with Yahshua. When you have it and you can see that he's given us a revelation. That's what that Shekinah was for. 40 years of Shekinah, of flashes of understanding the gospel, whereby we are to stand when we see the abomination and the desolation. If it was already written twain, you wouldn't have an abomination and a desolation come before you. There would be no need to stand in the holy place because it was already written. You would already know. You would already see the salvation of Yahweh. But what does Thessalonians say? Read. Come on
that
now.
That ye may be counted worthy.
Yes.
Of the kingdom of Yahweh.
Oh, there's a kingdom coming. They're in the kingdom. They're in the present kingdom age, but the kingdom of Yahweh. Read.
For which ye also suffer.
Now we suffer. We suffer here because we tear it on earth. Keep reading.
Seeing it is a righteous thing with Yahweh, yes, to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you.
Recompense it. That trouble. That say things that are not conducive to that which has been shown unto us by way of the panoramic vision given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley. Read.
And to you who are troubled with us.
And when you don't understand and you're troubled, and we study, what? Read it.
And to you who are troubled, rest with us.
Yes.
When Yahshua the Messiah shall be revealed from heaven.
Shall be revealed from heaven. Are we looking up now? Are we so pious to say he's up there in the sun, moon, and school and stars? Hey, remember being justified by the Spirit, and the Spirit has uttered the words that there's no earthly real heaven. There's no place Yahweh is sitting on a throne in that vernacular. You understand? Because Yahweh, as we know, is pure Spirit. He abides in everything, around and in and out of, right? And this is the heavenly state of where we're to return. Our origin is our destination. Not that Yahweh was lost and he was found. Yahweh ain't never been lost in his creation. He knew from the beginning to the end. We are coming into a realization of where we've come from, that we've been brought down and we came up in terror and we crossed and we're in a holding pattern here in Canaan's land. If we have a hope and have a love for one another to preach the true gospel of Yahshua Messiah, read.
When Yahshua the Messiah shall be revealed in heaven with his mighty angels.
He's going to come within our consciousness, within our understanding. Now, hey, if you understand the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, which is the gospel, when he comes preaching that same gospel, then you won't be, hey, I won't let it out the bag. You read it.
In flaming fire.
In flaming fire, this is going to be the gospel of the preaching of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Taking vengeance on them that know not Yahweh.
Oh, taking vengeance on who? Those that not accepting a statement or a comment? Or those who know not Yahweh? You can be in an understanding state within this realm that you're not going to get burned. And that's why we're here standing fast. Teaching all those and preaching until all the world, right? That's what it says over there in Matthew, the 24th chapter, preaching until all the world, huh? The death bearer, that's the gospel, huh? What's going to be the vengeance? What's going to be the fire? It's going to be the preaching of the gospel. What? To tear down this six compartmental veil within your consciousness when the time comes. You don't understand?
I really do.
You understand? When the time comes, we got a veil now. And we can contend with it. And we can be all right with a lot of things. And not used to be as we, our old man was. Right? We have a migratory pattern to take our picture. Hey, don't we say, hasn't it been taught to us that all those that came up from out of Egypt, right, that crossed the Red Sea and they tarried here in the wilderness for 40 years, all of those died off, save three, right? And Yahshua the Messiah. Those three are indicative of the God is of the unity of the Spirit. That's why there was three saved. Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar, right? That's typifying the Holy Spirit. That's all that's going to what? Cross over. That's going to be one body. Not separate bodies, but one body. A universal body of Yahshua the Messiah. What is that? Those that know Yahweh. By way of Yahshua the Messiah. We ain't just no about the cloud. We're not going to know nothing about the cloud until save Yahshua the Messiah, who going to bring vengeance on them that know not Yahweh, and read.
And that obey not the gospel of our Savior.
Talking about obey. Messiah. Didn't we say that Yahshua the Messiah died on the cross and I had the outpouring of the Holy Spirit? And we read over here the other day about how you have to abide by that Spirit law. You have to learn to see and understand and walk according to that Spirit walk, that spirit law that be in you, which is a righteous man, righteous steps that are in order. You're not dibbling and dabbling in what you used to and what you used to want to do and how you used to fantasize about and lust after. You know why? Because there was a new body that in allegorical, there was a new body that crossed over this Jordan River or this sixth step. And they crossed over all at once. Not individually, but all at once. By what? He went over by the first fruits. By that first fruit was Joshua the Messiah here, and it's going to be the first fruits that was going to led the captives in hell when he went back, when he was buried in this Joseph's new tomb, when he went back, right, and preached to the captives in hell these 4,000 years, because he came in on the fourth dispensation. He came back while he was buried, right? This is the state of mind of death. And when he did resurrect, he resurrected first. Because he returns over, repeats itself over and over and over again. That's why Moses had to get hold up here in Mount Nebo, and why Moses couldn't get over. Because, hey, people already think Moses done brought up out of the land of Egypt. Which is it has to be shown as a revelation to you to realize that Moses didn't do diddly squat. People don't realize and understand that until this day. That it was Yahshua the Messiah that's done the whole thing. And we have to realize that we have to stand fast and wait on that cloud. Just as they had to wait on that fiery cloud. Day and night. All the time. Until it was time for him to cross over here. And this by we went over on Thursday. About how Yahshua, that Moses was 120 years old.
Right.
And how Yahshua died at 110.
Right.
But they had to what? They had to wait for that jubilee or that liberation that had been 10 years after Yahshua died, bringing that whole full 120, which confirming that which was what happened with Moses down here. He went back and caught them all. That's where you can see all these men here. You understand? The souls that were buried in earth. They was dead. They was gone. But they still resurrected. And so we resurrect. They wait here in that altar of sin and incense here. Waiting for what? Knowing that this is intercessor is Yahshua the Messiah. And not us. Why else? If it was already written twain, why would we need an intercessor? When the Messiah said that, he's going to be our intercessor. And he's going to give the prayer to Yahweh. Because we know not how to pray. Right? And it's going to be Yahshua the Messiah, or the Holy Spirit. Not a man walking in and out, but a Holy Spirit going in and out. Because he's uttering things that we can't comprehend. Just as when they, at that Holy Spirit, got into them boys down here in Jerusalem. And the outpouring came down here. And they were speaking in tongues, they say. They couldn't utter and understand what they were talking about, right? Because it was a great mystery by which it was put into them at that particular time for them to be able able to express the true gospel of Yahshua Messiah. That's all it was for expressing. We say that true gospel since the day of Pentecost has been being expressed all the way down. But let's keep reading Thessalonians about that fire. About that fire that's yet to come. I said yet to come. Keep reading.
Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of Yahweh.
Oh, where's that destruction going to be? Is that going to be in a state of immortality? If it's immortal, there's no flesh. So how is that immortal going to burn up? That's just a question. That's just a thought that I have. If it's immortality, and then immortal means without the body and fleshly, where would there be a need in order to be burnt up? When the earth, I'm still digging holes on the job site. Huh? I'm still waking up by the cock that crows in the morning. I'm still in a physical body. Hey, my mind, by the grace of Yahshua the Messiah, can elevate me to perceive the things that I have yet to experience in a spiritual state and condition. That's what I don't know and understand about this new state, earth state. That's what's not understood. But I can perceive, I can look in. But I cannot be. Why? Because that fire is going to burn what? Keep reading.
Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of Yahweh?
From the presence of Yahweh. That means when you don't know, when it's done, the presence of Yahweh is going to be gone. Acts the 17th chapter say, know him while he yet may still be found. Why do you think Saul expresses that? What do we have? Romans 1:19 and 20. It takes the physical to understand the spiritual. There will be no need for it. There will be no physical here to understand in this new earth state in order to perceive anything about Yahweh. Why? Because when he shall appear, then what? Read.
And from the glory of his power.
Uh-huh.
When he shall come to be glorified in his sons, and to be admired in all them that believe.
Hey, we're all going to be individual, separate, but having one accord, being in one accord. As Jeremiah said, not preaching and teaching every man his own doctrine, but being within the one understanding. Well, I had to go back to the testimony to pick that up, because that's what it's taught us to understand why we know where we're at according to time. Keep reading.
Because our testimony among you was believed in that day.
In the day. In the day of eternity. It's all happening within the day of eternity. Because that day when that fire comes, it's going to consummate everything. I said our origin is our destination. And then once he solidifies everything, you're not going to be able to know him no more after the flesh. But you're going to be a son on earth now, having the understanding and the presence of Yahweh be in you. To what? Do your own thing? Go your own milly-willy way? Or to do that which Yahweh moves and directs you to do? Only for the building of the body. For those who are still gleaning while time yet persists. Read.
Wherefore also we pray always for you.
Oh, man. We do. Read.
That our Elohim would count you worthy of this calling.
Of a calling, not our calling to understand and to prove him. Him calling us, whereby we may be open-hearted to receive him when he calls. Read.
And fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness.
Hey, there's still yet a fulfilling. There's got to be a consummation of all of this. Whereby, hey, didn't he institute or start the world? The world's in here. It's got to be fulfilled. Got to be completed. That's what Peter talks about. They don't believe Peter. I think 1 in 28 or so. Talking about the consummation. It'll all be burnt up. Keep reading 2 Thessalonians.
And the work of faith.
The work of faith. The work of getting one to perceive to see the faith, which is Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
And the work of faith with power.
Yes.
That the name of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, may be glorified in you.
That's what we want. That if we read that again, brother.
that energy
the
in
name
it, read it.
Of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah,
yes.
may be glorified
yes.
in you,
yes.
and ye in him,
yes.
according to the grace of our Elohim,
yes.
and our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of that, all praises to Yahshua. We all wear our Elohim by Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love, and thank you to all of our speakers today. That will conclude today's lecture. Do we have any announcements? Okay. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful of your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.